Hello and welcome to Goa 365 Face to Face. Now this defection drama has been in people's faces for some time now. There have been people defecting from the MGP, from the Congress and joining the ruling BJP. Now with me is one of the legal team of one of the parties that has filed this petition against 10 defectors, the Congress party. When 10 of their MLAs, including the leader of opposition, defected and went into the BJP. Advocate Abhijit Kosavi, welcome to our show.
Thank you. Yes, I represented Mr. Girish Sudankar, who is the president of the Goa Congress. We had filed disqualification petition against the 10 defector. As you said in the beginning,
Dudar, what I want to start off is like to tell us, like yesterday full day you all were in the tribunal.
Yes.
In front of the speaker on this issue. So I wanted to know what is the status of the case in the petition, the case as of today.
Basically, it's some of the members from the MGP had also defected and joined Bharatiya Janata Party. So also subsequently 10 members from the Congress party had defected and joined Bharatiya Janata Party. So both these petitions were actually listed yesterday for the hearing. In the morning session, the petition which was filed by the MGP was taken up for hearing. After hearing in that case also, I am given to understand the speaker has reserved it for judgment. In the afternoon session, I think till about 6:30, the speaker heard the petition which was filed by the Congress party by Mr. Girish Sodankar. And in that matter also, the speaker, after hearing the matter at length, hearing the matter on merit, was pleased to reserve the matter for judgment.
Now, Girish Chodankar has filed the petition as the Goa Pradesh Congress Committee president, right?
Yes,
in the capacity as his president.
Yes, yes.
Correct.
He has been duly authorized by the office bearers in their meeting which was held on 24th of July 2019,
okay,
which was widely published also.
Okay.
He has been authorized and he had filed a petition on behalf of the party.
Okay. Now could you give us this?
Yes. So what had happened, so this incident of this 10 MLAs claiming to have merged the Indian National Congress Legislative Party into Bharatiya Janata Party happened on 10th of July 2019, you would recollect that.
Yes.
So thereafter, the Congress party took a resolution to question this illegal defection, whatever had taken place. And thereafter, on 8th of August 2019, way back in August of 2019, we had filed this disqualification petition before the speaker. So initially, there was one hearing conducted, which was called something as preliminary hearing by the honorable speaker. Thereafter, we heard nothing from him. So in fact, we went to him, we filed an application that, sir, we have filed a disqualification petition. According to us, all these members are liable to be disqualified under the 10 schedule. It's pending for some time. Please hear and decide it as soon as possible. Thereafter, again, we did not hear anything.
How long?
So basically from August, we filed this application in month of end of December. So nothing was happening. Thereafter, we got a notice somewhere in the end of January 2020 that he has scheduled the hearing on 13th of February 2020. So at that hearing, all the 10 defected MLAs were represented by their lawyer. At that point of time, now kindly note the date, it was on 13th of February 2020 that these people said that we want to file reply, give us some time. Fairly enough, we also said that they should file their response. Speaker gave them 4 weeks time to file their response. Thereafter, we did not hear anything. And in the interregnum, what had happened is that in a very detailed judgment, the Honorable Supreme Court, in the case of Kesham Meghachandra, authored by Justice Rowington, it laid down that basically the outer limit to decide a disqualification petition filed before the speaker is 3 months. So then we realized that in our case already the 3 months period had lapsed. So thereafter, in month of June or July, we went to the Supreme Court. We filed a SLP in the Supreme Court saying that we have filed a disqualification before Speaker. It's quite a time that it is pending consideration. It has not been decided. So please direct the Speaker to decide it in a time-bound manner. And more specifically in terms of the law laid down by the Honorable Supreme Court in case of Kesham Meghachandra, please tell him to decide. We also prayed that till the time this disqualification is petition is decided, this people who are occupying the ministerial position or people, they should not be allowed to, basically they should be stay on they enjoying those powers. The Honorable Supreme Court recorded the undertaking of the Speaker of the House, wherein it was undertook by the Speaker that this petition would be finally kept for disposal on 26th of February, on which basically he had issued a notice that we am keeping these matters for hearing. So Speaker's undertaking through the learned Solicitor General was recorded by the Honorable Supreme Court to say that yes, on 26th we will finally dispose this petition.
There is no specific time gap wherein he has to give the order. General precedent, or is there any?
There is no specific time as such, but we hope that he does it soon.
Okay.
And we hope that he does it maybe tentatively. I should inform you that the matter in the Supreme Court as per the tentative listing is shown for 8th of March.
Reason why I'm asking is not so much from the legal matters, but more because now the elections are also, the term of this is almost over. I'm looking at it from, anyway, that is not really the legal aspect. I was looking at it from that way. Now, before, like now we know the status. Now, what I wanted from you, Dottor, is the petition. Now, see now, X people went, they have they have some arguments now. You have some argument. So I wanted to know what was the petition and the general, the case, also on what basis?
The petition as we have filed is basically, in that petition we have sought that these 10 people who stood for election, obviously everybody knows, on the tickets of Indian National Congress. Their candidature was set up by Indian National Congress.
That B form and whatever.
They were yes, all those formalities. Obviously, they were candidate of Indian National Congress.
Correct.
They stood elected to the 7th Assembly of the Goa Assembly as the member of Indian National Congress. Till July of 2019, I guess, they attended 9 sessions of the Assembly as the member of Indian National Congress. Obviously, the concerned speaker had allotted them the seats in the house, considering them to be members of Indian National Congress. They attended 9 sessions. So thereafter, on 10th of July, they make a communication to the speaker to tell that we are the 2/3 members of the legislative Indian National Congress legislative party, and we have merged with the Bharatiya Janata Party. So I'll come to that. What's wrong in that? I'll come to that. So I'm just telling that why we went and what was the occasion and need for us to file a disqualification petition.
Okay.
Thereafter, all these members, as per the records which are available with the Speaker's office and which are available in public domain.
Yeah.
All of them are shown to be the members of Bharatiya Janata Party. You could very well go to the website of the Speaker Assembly itself. You will see that all these members, all these MLAs today are Bharatiya Janata Party's MLA. So now, what's wrong in that? The very rightly asked by you. The wrong is that this amounts to disqualification in terms of Schedule 10 of our Constitution.
Okay.
Which says that if any person voluntarily gives up his membership, then he has incurred disqualification and he is disqualified under the 10th schedule. Our democracy, the basic principles of democracy were seen to be challenged, because you get elected on one party's ideology, you get elected on one party's candidature as a candidate of a political party, and then for your own gains, which we know what are the gains and what some these MLAs are looking at and what are their intentions, are simply changing their parties. So it thereafter, from 67, I think it took around 17 years for us to get this law. That law is anti-defection law, which is nothing but the 10th schedule, which came to be introduced in the Constitution of India in the year 1985. In year 1985, through 52nd Constitutional Amendment, 10th schedule was introduced.
Okay.
Now, what this 10th schedule provided is that if any person, or so not person, any elected member, if he voluntarily gives up his membership of his original political party, then he disqualifies. if he votes or abstain from voting contrary to the direction given by his political party, then he gets disqualified. If an independent MLA joins a political party, then he gets disqualified. Now, all these things are provided in para 2 of the 10th schedule.
Okay.
Now, before even going to para 2, we need to understand have a look or refer to some definition. The 10th schedule specifically defines what is the original political party and what is the legislative party, which could be relevant in the context of subject we are discussing and in the context we started with. That both things are properly defined. So now the original political party is obviously, to say it in a very generic sense, is the party on whose ticket you stood for election and you got elected. Now what is this legislative party? Legislative party are all those MLAs or the candidate who stood elected from a particular party. That group is basically referred to as legislative party of that particular party. So now with this, the issue is now this takes us, now these are the definition. Now in para 2 you get that who are to be disqualified when you incur disqualification. Now when we started in 1985 with this disqualification law, there were two exceptions,
okay,
or two exemptions which were created within the 10th schedule. Okay. And what were those exemptions or the defenses is that firstly, if there was a split which was provided in para 3 of the 10th schedule, you would not be disqualified. Even though you voluntarily give up your membership, then you won't be disqualified. The second thing was merger. That if your original political party merges, then also there was a that you were not subject to the rigors of disqualification. These were the two exceptions which were there. We, as Goan, we are aware of this, that various instances took place when there were issues of split. What is actually the split? It fell for interpretation before various court. Eventually, the Honorable Supreme Court finally decided that split is not only required in your members as the MLAs, but also in the original political party, okay, from which you had contested. That there are a lot of judgment, we don't refer to it, because finally in 2003, based on the report of a law commission, wherein it was stated that this provision of split has been misused and it is basically going contrary to the aims and objective of the anti-defection law. So okay, therefore, in the 91st amendment to the constitution, the concept of split was taken away, it was removed from the 10th schedule. So today as we stand, there is only one exception. Only one exception which any of the members of the house can tell that I have not incurred disqualification, if he is able to show that there is a valid merger in terms of para 4 of the 10th schedule.
What is this para 4
of
the 10th schedule?
So I'll elaborate on what is para 4. But before even going to para 4, we need to keep one thing in mind. And in fact, which I happened to tell the speaker also yesterday at the time of the hearing, that when we interpret these provisions of the 10th schedule, we need to keep one thing in mind, that what was the aim and the objective with which this 10th schedule was introduced. Mm-hmm. It was to deter defection. It was to prevent defection. It was to ensure that the people do not defect from the original political party on which candidature they have got elected. That was the intent, that was the objective of the act. So while we interpret any provision of this 10th schedule, we need to keep it at back of our mind that this is what we are looking at. We are not looking at promoting defection. We are not looking at facilitating defection. We are looking at a provision which was created to stop this evil. It was created to ensure that evil of defection does not destroy our democratic setup. That was the intent. Now, what is this para 4? Para 4 basically says that if your original political party decides to merge and it merges with another political party, then and thereafter the legislature, 2/3 of the legislature member agree to such merger, then there will be a valid merger in eyes of law or in terms of para 4 of the 10th schedule, and then you won't incur the disqualification. Now, here it is that the exact meaning and what is the mandate of para 4 is sometimes deliberately misinterpreted, or there is a confusion among the minds of the general public that what it is. Because there is an attempt to create a perception to say that we are the members or we are the MLAs who have got elected. I gathered together two-thirds of the members and I said that I have decided to merge, therefore I have merged my party. Is it possible in terms of para 4? If you ask me, no. The answer is straightforward, no.
Why?
Because the para 4 itself has a particular formula. And what is that formula? The formula is this, that firstly, the original political party should take a decision to merge.
Okay.
The second step, and both these prerequisites have to be there. The second step is that basically, if you have a legislature party, at least 2/3 of those members.
Okay.
So if you have 10 members, 2/3 of those 10 should agree to the merger, the decision of the merger, which has been taken by the political party.
I see. Oh.
So you as a member of the legislative party or you as an MLA don't have the decision making power.
Okay.
You are basically the, if you read sub para 2 of para 4, it says these members are entitled to agree to such a merger. So the power or the mandate which they have is to either disagree or agree. If at least 2/3 of the member of the legislature party agree, then the merger will go through. If they don't agree, the merger will not happen. So the limited scope and the ambit and the powers which are given to these members of the assembly is basically to agree or disagree to the decision of merger. It says agreed to such merger. Now that term such merger, such merger refers to a merger which has already taken place, because it is not your decision making power, it is your agreement or disagree. So correct. To what you will agree? You will agree to a decision which has already been taken somewhere else.
Absolutely, yes.
So, if original party has taken a decision, then you either agree or you disagree.
Okay. Now, I just want to a little bit of clarification on this. Now, you are talking about this party and the merger and all that. Now, this is, see, now suppose, say for example, Congress party only.
Right.
Or you take BJP.
Yes.
Now, there is a national BJP.
Yes.
And then there are state-wise.
Yes.
So, what? Yeah. Now, the merger of the party has to break where? It has to break at central level, it has to break in the state, so it has to break among all the states or only the state where it has.
Correct.
So that is a little confusing.
In the context of Congress, if you look, it has to be the national. It's a national recognized party.
Yes.
It's a nationally recognized national party, recognized by the Election Commission of India.
Okay,
so if at all a decision of merger, the decision has to be taken by the national party.
Okay.
Now, as far as the state is concerned, the role of the MLAs is in the House, is in the Assembly, that they take a decision, and it is rightly so. In our democracy, neither of them should be given supremacy. For a simple reason, that when somebody stands for election on a particular party's candidature, as a candidate of a particular party, he uses their platform, he uses their ideology, he uses their, uses the platform which has been created by the party for so long, by their workers, by their leaders, so he uses that. Say at the same time, simultaneously, the individual who is standing for election and getting elected has his own identity to contribute, because he has his own identity, he has his own well-wisher, he has his own reputation, he has his own resources which are put to disposal to get elected. So neither of them should be given supremacy. Both of them should have a say, and rightly so. Our legislature or the legislature who created this 10 schedule have rightly created this balance, a sort of a counterbalance between both of them, that you individually as a political party will not be able to create a merger in terms of fourth schedule. So also you individually as a members of the House cannot individually take a decision and say that we are going to merge and we have merged our party. So it's a counterbalance or counterbalancing forces which have been basically created, that if the original political party takes a decision to merge, it should be supported or agreed upon by at least 2/3 of the legislative members.
That means of the state.
Yes. And it is not possible or it cannot be mandated in terms of para 4 that a members of the legislative party independently takes a decision that we want to merge. That is what exactly has happened in MGPs or in the Congress case, the cases you referred in the beginning. What has happened is the people who are the member or the elected representative in the House have thought that since they have a 2/3 number with them, we will say that it's a merger. Now there is a dimming fiction in the para 2 of para 4, which is basically being used to create this perception that I had 2/3 member, therefore I merge. What's wrong in that? And you rightly asked me also in the beginning, what's wrong in that? True. They had the number, they went there.
Exactly.
So the answer to this is this, that you had no power to take that decision. In terms of para 4, you were never given that power that you will independently take a decision that I am merging my political party. Because merger in terms of para 4 is merger of the original political party. It does not provide for merger of the legislature party.
Okay.
If you read it minutely, you will see it says merger of the original political party with other political party, which means what is being merged is the original political party
with the another party.
And in this both these cases, if you I don't want to get into minutes, but if you see what was communicated to the speaker and what the speaker also took cognizance is that they say that we are merging legislative party with Bharatiya Janata Party.
It said
that communication, it's a notified bulletin notified by the speaker himself. If you see the it's 3-4 pages bulletin which was issued, it says that these 10 members or those 2 members of the legislative party have decided to merge with Bharatiya Janata Party. That is not even provided under the para 4.
Okay.
There is no concept of you somebody saying that I am going to merge my legislative party with some other political.
I just want one thing. Now, this is a legal point, right?
Yes.
This is a legal argument because it's a tribunal and
yes.
Supreme Court and XY. So, what I am saying is, do you have any cases or precedents to buttress this argument of yours?
Yes. In fact, there are precedent, there are judgments of various high court. Even the Supreme Court has laid down the formula. In fact, it says under the para 4 of the 10th schedule, there is a formula.
Okay.
That formula which I explained. There are specific, very clear judgments of Punjab and Haryana High Court, two of them. There is a judgment of Allahabad High Court, which clearly says that for a valid merger in terms of para 4 of 10th schedule, two things are required. One, your original political party should take a decision to merge, and that decision has to be agreed upon by at least 2/3 of the member.
Okay.
Now, para 2 also says that it will be deemed to have merged. The original political party would have deemed to have been merged if 2/3 of the members of the legislative party agree. Now, this is where the confusion is created, either deliberatory or because of confusion. That
interpretation.
Interpretation is to say that once I have 2/3 member, it is deemed that original party has got merged. But before applying that deeming fiction, you need to understand that while interpreting a deeming fiction, you first need to understand that why that deeming fiction is created.
Okay.
You need to understand the purpose of the deeming fiction.
Okay.
And it's a law, it's a well settled law that you cannot travel beyond the scope or the purpose for which the deeming provision is created. Now you will obviously ask me that what is the purpose of creating a deeming fiction in this para 2.
Correct.
The purpose is this, that for example, take a situation that you have a political party or there's a political party which takes a decision that we want to merge. Okay, one step is clear. The first requirement
of the party
is done. Now, then second requirement is that it has to be also approved or agreed by 2/3 of the members. In this situation, you consider 10 people, 9 people agree to merger. One person doesn't agree. Then do you mean to say that merger will not take place? It is for this purpose that if 2/3 of the people have agreed to the merger, then it will be deemed to have taken purpose. You can't expand the purpose of this deeming fiction to say that because I have 2/3 member, even my original political party has merged. That's not the intent or the purpose of para 4.
Thanks, Advocate Goswami. Thanks, it was a pleasure. Though technical, but I think it has come out in the open what exactly the whole argument, the legal argument, and this is about, which I think would probably help to clear a little bit of haze and this and that. Thank you.
Thank you. It was my pleasure to be on your show.
It's our pleasure also. Thank you very much. And keep watching Goa 365.